Hachette Audio presents The Thicket, written by Joe R. Lansdale, read by Will Collyer. Dedication for Terrell Lee Langford. We remember our lives as if they were fables. Anonymous. Chapter 1. I didn't suspect the day Grandfather came out and got me and my sister Lula and hauled us off toward the ferry that I'd soon end up with worse things happening than had already come upon us, or that I'd take up with a gun-shooting dwarf, the son of a slave, and a big angry hog, let alone find true love and kill someone. But that's exactly how it was. It was the pox got it all started. It had run through the country like a runaway mule, and had been especially unkind to the close-by town of Hingegate. It showed up there as a bumpy, oozing death, and killed so many it was called an epidemic. Two of the ones that died were our Ma and Pa, and neither of them had ever been sick a day in their lives. I, on the other hand, was sickly all my early life, up until the time I got my health. And Lula had been kind of scrawny her whole time, but neither of us took it. I was by this time a healthy 16-year-old, and she was 14 and right on the verge of her bloom. That old pox passed us by as if it was blind in one eye. It crept up on Ma and Pa, fevered them up, covered them in blisters, and made it so when they tried to breathe, it sounded like a busted squeeze box. The worst thing was, we had to sit and watch them die, and there wasn't a damn thing we could do about it. We couldn't even touch them for fear of coming down with it. Pox ran all through the town like it was looking for money. Dead people were piled up outside houses, loaded in wagons, buried quickly. In some cases, they were burnt when nobody knew who they were, as there were folks who traveled through town and got it and died without leaving information on their names or where they'd been going. Sheriff Gaston finally had to put signs out on the roads coming in that said nobody could leave and spread it, and nobody could come in for fear of getting it. There was people who burnt smoke pots around their houses and inside, thinking that would keep the pox out, but that didn't help. It just made it smoky and caused the ones who had it to have a harder time breathing than before. We lived out on the edge of town, and I always figured it was the tinker who brought it around, carried it to our place like it was one of the wares in his wagon. I think when my Pa shook hands with him and bought a skillet, that was the end of it. He and Ma came down with it right away, though that tinker didn't have a spot of it on him that I could see. Right away, I rode into town on the mule and fetched the doctor. He came out, seen right off, saving them was like trying to bring to life an oil painting. Wasn't a thing he could do, though he gave them a couple pills to take, just so as to look like he was trying. A few days later, Ma and Pa got real bad, and I rode into town to see if I could get the doctor back out. Doctor had died himself of it and was already buried, and someone had left a burning smoke pot on his grave. I knew that because I seen it out there in the cemetery when I was riding in, and then seen it again going out, knowing then whose grave it was. I guess someone thought that smoke would keep it from spreading from the dead body. Hard to know what people were really thinking, because that pox had not only killed a good bunch of folks, it had scared the living and taken their reason, and mine wasn't all that good either. When I got back home, Ma and Pa were both dead. And there was Lula out in the yard crying, a strangled chicken still flopping in one hand, because she was setting about making dinner, even with them dead in the house. Me and Lula had been living out under a tree to stay out of the way of getting the pox, and we cooked out there and ate out there. Grandpa would come in and check on Ma and Pa, because he couldn't catch it. He'd had it and lived through it when he was younger, and he couldn't get it anymore. He caught it way up among the Cheyenne near the Wind River Range, which was nowhere close to where we were in East Texas. He got it the same way the Cheyenne did, some infected blankets given to them by white folks as a kind of joke. He was a missionary and had lived up there with them. Both he and Grandma had it and lived, and then some years later, Grandma was run over by a frightened cow near Gilmer, Texas, while she was trying to calm it down for milking. The pox couldn't kill her, but a cow that didn't want to be milked had. I barely remember Grandma. I guess I must have been about 5 when that cow done her in. Lula was 3 years old. Grandpa, according to family story, shot the cow and ate it. I guess he considered that was getting even, having a steak made of the murderer. I never heard him speak sadly of the death of Grandma or the cow, but he and Grandma seemed to have gotten along fine, and up until that day, neither he nor the cow had experienced a minute's trouble, I've been told. On the day Ma and Pa died, I went in and looked at them, but I didn't stand too close, and I didn't touch nothing. They looked horrible, all pocked over and bloody where they had scratched, and those little odd blisters with the dents in the middle had broken open and bled. I rode our tired old mule over to Grandpa, who lived down from us a little ways, and he put on his dusty suit coat and hat and rode back beside me, driving his wagon. He brought with him some sacks of lime he had for his garden and a couple of pine boxes he had already built, being pretty certain what was coming. He had also packed some bags and put them in the wagon too, but at the time I didn't know what that was about and was too stunned to ask. If a pig had flown by with a deck of cards in its teeth, it wouldn't have fazed me. Me and Grandpa dug graves for Ma and Pa. Because Grandpa couldn't get the pox, he rolled them onto fresh sheets, dragged them out of the house, lifted them into those coffins, and poured lime on them. I helped him lower the coffins down in the holes with rope. He said when we were covering them up, he felt the lime would hold back the disease so it wouldn't spread from their bodies and give it to others. I don't know. I figure 6 feet of dirt helped quite a bit. We got them buried, and he preached some words over them with the Bible in his hand, but I couldn't tell you what section he preached from. I was too stunned to tell. And Lula looked as if her mind had gone to a place no one could find. She hadn't said anything since I found her with the dead chicken, which we had ended up tossing in a ditch. When he finished up with the preaching, he set fire to the house and put us in the wagon and started us out, my old mule tied on a rope line behind the wagon. "Where are we going?" I said, looking back at our blazing home. It was all I knew to say. Lula was all huddled up and not talking at all. Anyone didn't know her, they'd have thought she was a pretty mute.
"Well, Jack," Grandpa said, without so much as looking over his shoulder, "we're not going back to that burning house, that's for sure. You're going on up to Kansas to stay with your Aunt Tessel."
"I don't even know I've met her," Lula said, this being something that brought her out of her stupor and gave her a tongue.
She said it so suddenly and unexpectedly I hopped a little, and I think Grandpa did too.
"I barely remember her," I said.
"Be that as it is, you're going to live with her," Grandpa said. "She don't know it yet, but I figured it might be best not to give her time to recollect on it. We'll spring a surprise on her. And considering I'm planning on staying as well, though I'll come a little later so as not to overwhelm the situation, it'll be a surprise. Never cared for Tessel, actually, as she always seemed to be Mama's favorite, but tragedy makes strange bedfellows."
"You're sure that's the best way?" I said. "Just showing up?"
"It might not be the best way," he said, "but it'll be our way. I'll tell you, too, another thing. I saw this coming, and I've sold off all my livestock, except these 2 mules. And you have your pa's mule, and now you have contracts for both pieces of land, your father's and mine. They're in the bank at Sylvester. I didn't put them in your hometown bank, because I figured with all the pox going on, there was just too much confusion. I have set it all up with a lawyer named Cowton Little. He's to sell the property for a fair price when you're ready and give you 2 the money, minus his commission, of course. I have no idea how long this will take, but mine is prime real estate when the town grows out, and it will. Your folks' land is good land, too, soon as the pox passes, and there's no consideration on how they died. It, too, will be prime. You understand in all this?"
We both said we understood, though Lula seemed to have drifted away again, like a balloon. She was flighty enough under normal circumstances, always wondering about the shape of clouds and asking about why things were green or some such, and never taking "God made it that way" as an answer. She was always looking for some greater truth, like there was one,
Grandpa used to say she always had to figure that if there was a hole in the ground, something was in it, and for a reason, and it had a history, even if she couldn't see it. She never could, except a hole might be empty. And if something was in it, it might not have thought on why or how it got there at all.
Beware a woman that wants reasons for everything, he said.
Grandpa reached inside his suit coat and pulled out a paper, said,
This here is all the paperwork you'll need on the matter of the property. I go up to Kansas, I won't be coming back, and you might not either. But you can do your dealings with the lawyer by mail, you need to.
I took the papers you gave.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.